Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Welcome back to the part 2 session of chapter Evolution. In part 1, we saw up to evidences of evolution. Now we will move ahead to a new concept called natural selection. So what you are seeing on the slide here is different varieties of dogs. Same way here you are finding two varieties of corn. Now these new varieties of dogs or the new varieties of any crop has come because of the breeding experiment that human beings have performed over the years. So in the last 100 to 200 years you can say, man was responsible for bringing new varieties into the nature. But what is important here to understand is, if these new varieties were not fit enough to survive and leave behind progeny, then their existence would not have been there today. That means nature has played a great role, and that is what is known as natural selection. Let's see the definition. So natural selection is a process wherein organisms which are better adapted to their environment tend to survive and produce more offspring. So looks like in selecting the new varieties, it is the nature which is playing important role. Okay, if they are unfit, they would not be living further. But if they are fit, and fit in what way? Not only in survival, but also in leaving behind progeny and increasing their population. So that is what is known as natural selection. Now, if this could happen so quickly, that means the breeding experiments could give rise to new varieties so quickly in a few years, that means in nature, throughout these millions of years, nature must have done a similar thing. It must have, from time to time, selected fit varieties, left them in that particular environment. The minute the environment changed and they were unfit, they were discarded. Okay? Let us see one classic example of natural selection. So have a very close look at the slide. We will understand what exactly this industrial melanism phenomenon. So you can listen to this like a story and you will understand it very well. So here I have shown moth Bistan betularia, that's a scientific name. There are two types of moth. One is the dark variety and one is the light variety. So the dark variety is because of melanin deposition, pigment deposition. Whereas here the white variety does not have the pigment deposition, but both are belonging to the same species, Bistan betularia. Now this was in England and they were living in the forest area. The forest had trees covered with lichens. What are lichens? Lichen is an association of fungus and algae. So the entire barks were covered with this light color lichens. So if you do not know what are lichens, let me show it to you here. So this is how the branches get covered with lichens. And lichens usually grow where there is no pollution in the surrounding area. The minute there is pollution, lichens will not be able to grow on the barks of the trees. Okay? So these are the lichens. You can see here this growth. So there are different types of lichens. What I am talking about here in this example are the light colored lichens. So what I was telling you here is, let's begin with the story once again. There is Bistan betularia in the forest of England. Then there are two varieties of that, dark one and the light one. Then the trees are covered with lichens, and what happens is this moth, it's a type of a moth. So this moth goes and settles during the daytime on this tree barks. So what will happen is a predator bird will be able to easily spot the dark variety because of the contrast. Whereas the white variety will easily camouflage. What is camouflaging? Merging with the background and not easily spotted by this bird. So when they did a study of this, what they found is the number of the white moth was considerably low as compared to, the white moth was considerably higher as compared to the black moth. That is because the black moth was continuously predated upon by this bird. Now came a situation, look at it very carefully on the slide. Now came a situation where in England they started industrial revolution. So because of the industrial revolution, lot of smoke was emitted because coal was burnt, and when the coal is burnt, you know, lot of smoke is given out. And what happened is the trees in this forest, nearby forest, they were now covered by the soot. Soot is the carbon deposition from the smoke. The entire tree bark started getting covered with soot. There was no scope for the lichens to grow now. I told you, lichens cannot grow in polluted area. Now see the situation, what happened. Have a close look at the slide. The white moth became very prominent on the background of the black one, okay? And the black one easily merged with the surrounding. In fact, you can't even see it. That's why I have put a red color circle around it. So the black one easily merged, camouflaged, and the white one was easily spotted by the bird. And in this new situation, in this new environment, the bird came and picked up the white one. Again, when the studies were done, they found that this time the white population was less and the black moth population was increasing. Just the opposite of this. Okay? This shows that nature operates according to the situation. Whatever is fit in one situation was picked up. Whatever is fit in the other situation was picked up. In other words, selected by the nature. Fine? So this is about the industrial melanism. What is not mentioned in your textbook is after the coal was replaced with electricity, once again the situation reversed because now there was no soot deposition. But since it is not mentioned in the textbook, we'll learn only these situations before the industrial revolution and after the industrial revolution. Before industrial revolution, the black moth's population was less. After industrial revolution, the white moth population was less. Clear? Next topic is evolution by anthropogenic action. Anthropogenic meaning human action. So can human action also bring about creation of new species, knowingly or unknowingly? It is possible. We are learning two examples. Now we know a lot of chemical pesticides are used in the fields to kill the pest. Let us say there are pests like microbes, there are worms, there are insects which come to destroy the crop, to eat the crop there. So you use heavy pesticides, chemicals basically. What happens is most of the pests will be killed. Let us talk about this bacteria. So let us imagine majority of them died, but a few remained. Why they remained is because they had the genes to resist that pesticide. So they were called pesticide resistant bacteria. So they were present and they survived. And now while most of them died, these few ones which survived, they started increasing like anything. And over a period of time, the same pesticide was useless against them. So what did man do? He started bringing one more type of pesticide, another chemical compound. Same thing happened again. There were some varieties in this new population of bacteria now which were resistant even to that new pesticide. They remained. They increased in number. So like this, in a very short period of time, human beings have created pesticide resistant varieties into this nature. Another example, antibiotic resistant microbes. So whenever we have bacterial infection, what we do is we take antibiotics. So antibiotics will kill most of this bacteria, but there may be some which are antibiotic resistant because they have those genes. They will survive, and when they survive, they will start increasing in number. So if you look at this picture, you find that the green ones are dead, but the others remain and they are the antibiotic resistant. They started increasing. Now when you are using another antibiotic, because the same antibiotic is not going to work against them. So new antibiotic may kill, maybe let us say these blue ones will be killed, remaining ones will remain. So this is how in a short period of time, because of constant change in the antibiotics that human beings do, we have created so many antibiotic resistant bacteria. So this is called evolution through anthropogenic action. now a new concept, adaptive radiation. Adaptive radiation concept was given by Charles Darwin. So this is the photograph of Charles Darwin, is called the father of evolution because of his contribution in the study of evolution. So he has done his studies in different places. In fact, he has visited so many different kinds of ecosystems, so many different kinds of habitats, and he has actually studied all the organisms in these areas. So when he went to one such area called Galapagos Islands, Galapagos Island has almost around more than 20 islands, small islands. And why he chose this place is because there are different kinds of habitats here. And the organism found there, they're so unique that he called them endemic ones, not found anywhere else. They're unique and they're found only on this island. So he studied this island and he found there is one particular bird called the black finch. They were found in different habitats on that island. All of them were looking very similar, but the difference was in their beak pattern. So you see, here itself in the diagram, in the picture, you can see some of them have very thin, delicate beak. Some of them have quite broad and strong but short beak. So this kind of variation in the beak pattern proved that they also fed on different food items. Some of them could have been eating insects, some of them could have been eating leaves, some were seed eaters. So when he studied, when Darwin studied this in detail, what he found is this, that originally all these finches, today they are called Darwinian finches. So all these black finches, originally they were seed eating type. But the competition for the food must have been so much that some of them were forced to migrate to the nearby areas, to the nearby habitats. So those which went in certain region, the only food available for them was, let us say in this condition, birds. Bird is a very soft tissue. Now they had to eat that. So those which had a slight variation in their beak and they could eat the birds, they survived and they started increasing in number. Same thing might have happened here when they started feeding on the insect, because the only food available there was the insect. So some those could easily take that insect through their beak, digest it, they survived, and those which could not, they died. So they started increasing in number. So like this, from a common stock, that is all seed eating type, you got this kind of variety. This is called adaptive radiation, beginning from one point and literally radiating to different geographical area. Look at the different birds here. All are black finches, but see the difference in their beak pattern. Some are cactus feeders, some are insect feeders, some are seed feeders. Even in the seed feeders, there will be variation in the beak, because some seeds may be very small, very hard, some may be soft, some may be big. So there may be variation even amongst the seed eating kind of beak pattern. So this is what is known as adaptive radiation. So let's see the definition now. Adaptive radiation is a process of evolution of different species in a given geographical area, starting from a common point and literally radiating to other areas of geography or habitat. That is what we saw in the Darwinian finches. Let's take one more example. Marsupials in Australia. Marsupials are those mammals which have a pouch and they nourish their young ones in the pouch at least for some time. So those are called the marsupial mammals. Now, according to the study of evolution, there was only one original type of marsupial, a very short, with very short limbs and all. This kind of marsupial existed several years back, and over a period of time, due to their need for food, or maybe due to their need to hide from their enemies and all, they might have gone to different habitat and accordingly got adapted there. So we have some organism which are burrowing type, some are ant eaters, some are tree dwellers like the squala. So some are living in the burrows, some are adapted to flight, somewhat like the bats. They are called the sugar gliders. So from the original stock, so much of diversification, this is adaptive radiation. Simultaneously, while this was happening in Australia, One more kind of adaptive radiation was happening in the placental mammals. Placental mammals, in contrast, are those mammals who have a placenta. So, these placental mammals, you see, there was a common ancestral stock, somewhat like a shrew, and then from this small short-limbed organism, again there is a diversification. Some of them are adapted again to burrowing type, some are adapted to aquatic mode, some are tree dwellers, some are flying, showing flight kind of mode. So similar type of adaptation was also shown by the placental mammal. So if you have a very close look at these two examples, or even Darwinian finches example, one thing is clear: through this adaptive radiation, we are actually understanding divergent evolution. Isn't it like divergent evolution, what we have already studied? From a common stock, diversification, that means different lines of evolution. Fine? But if we compare marsupial radiation with placental radiation, because it happened at the same time. So if we compare these two, see what we are observing. So I have shown placental mammals here and some Australian marsupials here. Now if you compare any two, let us say placental mammal mole and Australian marsupial mole, both are adapted to common lifestyle, that is burrowing type. So isn't it like convergent evolution here? What I said earlier is, if you are only comparing the marsupial mammals amongst themselves, or only considering Australian mammals, Australian marsupials among themselves, that's divergent evolution. Like in the earlier slide, and we show you the earlier slide. See, this is divergent evolution. Again, this is divergent evolution. But now if you are comparing two different adaptive radiation, one of the placental mammals and one of the Australian mammal, we find they are actually converging to a common lifestyle. So for every placental mammal, there appears to be a similar corresponding marsupial. So this is one example. You can take any other example. You take mouse and marsupial mouse, flying squirrel, flying phalanger. So that's about the convergent evolution when we compare two different adaptive radiation. Here it is the placental mammal and the Australian mammals. So now the new topic is biological evolution. I have shown two petri dishes, two culture plates of bacteria here. So look at the first culture plate. Bacteria are growing there. I have shown them in red and white color. They are growing there abundantly. That's called a bacterial colony A. And the nutrient that is given to them, the carbohydrate source they would require for their growth, that is nutrient X. We'll just call it X. So they are flourishing like anything, taking that food. And now, after some time, what you do is, instead of giving X food, you give it Y, some other carbohydrate source. So when you are giving, when you are changing the nutrient medium, what has happened is, some of the bacteria survived and they started multiplying, whereas some, that means I have not shown the red ones here. That means in the original population, there were two types of varieties. Pay attention very carefully. There were two types of bacteria strains there. One was able, both of them were able to digest the X. But when the nutrient was changed, one of that could not digest Y because they did not have the genes. Did not have the genes to produce enzyme to digest the new food source. And those which had that gene, they were selected by nature and they started growing into, ultimately with time, into a totally separate colony called bacterial colony V. So this is also an example of natural selection. But only thing is what? It has happened very quickly in a matter of few days. That's why what we are saying here is that appearance of new life, new forms, depends on lifespan. Bacterial lifespan is very short. So naturally, the evolution did not take millions of years. It happened in a very short period of time. Nature selects fittest individuals in the changing environment. So when the environment changed, that means the food source was changed, the nature selected only those who could digest it. Now, there has to be a genetic basis if at all adaptation has to take place. And this genetic basis has to be transmitted to the next generation. So all these new bacteria which are there in the second culture plate, all are able to digest that Y. So this is how in nature, depending on the lifespan, new varieties comes, and in long run they turn into new species. The next topic is branching, descent and natural selection. Now we know so much about natural selection, that the nature chooses the fittest individuals and discards the one which are unfit. Now what is this branching, descent? Again, the concept is given by Charles Darwin. So what he says is, okay, let's see, look at this this picture first. So we have one species, species 1. Over a period of time, species 1 has given rise to species 2, then later on to species 3 and species 4, and species 4 has given rise to species 5. That means one thing is clear, the evolution is not just like a straight line. Species 1 giving species 2, then giving species 3. It's not a linear line of evolution. It is like a branching pattern. So we have one species, then it branches out. It may branch out into more than 3-4 species. Some may become extinct on the way. From there, another branching may occur. So this is what is known as branching descent. And that is what Charles Darwin observed. So you can even take this example, what we have already learned about the homologous organ, as an example for branching descent. So all these organisms came from the common stock, and then they started descending in different lines of evolution. Okay, now this topic, Lamarckism or Lamarck's idea of evolution. That means Lamarck also believes that evolution has taken place. His studies, much before Darwin actually, says he has a little different view about evolution as compared to Darwin. So what he says is, he takes the example of this giraffe. Now today when we look at the giraffe, we all know they have a very, very long neck and they can easily reach to the branches of tall trees as their food. What Lamarck says is that originally the ancestors of giraffe were deer-like, very short limbs, very short neck. But when the food that they were usually feeding on small plants or maybe also on the grass. But when this was not available, the area became barren, only thing that was available for them was to feed on the tall trees. That means they had to now compulsorily feed on the tall trees, reach to the foliage. Those giraffe which could stretch their neck continuously and reach to the branches, higher branches, they survived. And they passed this acquired characteristic of elongated neck due to continuous stretching to the next generation. That is what Lamarck says. So look at the statement, what Lamarck says, that any acquired physical change in the organism during its lifetime, in the same lifetime, such as greater development of an organ or its part through increased use. Here, what is the increased use? Continuous stretching. Increased use is transmitted to the offspring. So the new offsprings which are born of this giraffe with elongated neck will also have elongated neck. But then how was it proved wrong that this cannot happen? Change that has taken place in the somatic cell, body cells, cannot be passed to the next generation. How was it proved? Is with this simple example. Look at the example here. The tribal women, we know they wear metal rings around their necks. Why? They started at a very early stage so that the neck will start elongating, because it is considered as a sign of beauty to have thin, long neck. Okay. So by the time they are in their late 20s or early 30s, you can say the neck has considerably increased in size. But we know that when they will give rise to their children, the children will not have elongated neck. If Lamarck was correct, the children should have been born with long neck. Similarly, another scientist called Weismann, he performed an experiment. He started cutting the tails of the rats for 22 generations. And he found that every time the new generation was born, it was not tailless, it was with the tail. So once and for all, Lamarckism theory was discarded. Next topic is influence of Thomas Malthus on Darwin. Now, Thomas Malthus basically has done a study on population. So, what Thomas Malthus says is that all the members in a population, they have this ability to increase, undergo reproduction and give birth to large number of progeny. Fine. Only condition is what? The food should be available. If food is abundant, unlimited, then the population will increase exponentially. What is exponential increase? There will be a sharp increase in the number of organism in the coming years. But we know that it is impossible. There will be famines, there will be heavy rainfall, less rainfall, earthquakes may be there. Some disturbance may be there for which food supply will be limited. And this is the reason why the population will not be able to undergo complete exponential growth. There will be a decline in the human population. That is what Malthus said. Through this, Charles Darwin, whatever he understood from this, he has put forth now that yes, resources will always be limited. With changing time, the food resources are also going to be limited, and those individuals in a population who are able to procure food in an efficient manner, they will be the ones who will survive. Okay, so he believes that yes, there will be limited resources, but in this limited resources, if you are able to take up that limited resource far efficiently, then you will survive, otherwise you will not survive. That is what Charles Darwin says, and over a period of time, you will leave behind more progeny and you will be successful as a new species. Okay, now let's study evolution of life forms, a theory. Now that we know about Charles Darwin's contribution to the evolution, to the theory of evolution, let's also understand this. You may be asked for 1 mark. The name of the ship that he had traveled in, HMS Beagle. He has roamed all around the globe in different habitats, as I had told you, in this ship, HMS Beagle. Same time, while Charles Darwin was doing his studies, in Malayan archipelago, archipelago is again a group of island, Alfred Wallace also has done his studies. And both of them have come to similar conclusions, similar observations, and then similar conclusions. What are they? So according to them, existing living forms share similarities with each other and also with those which lived in the past. Now, if you look at this statement, one thing is clear. This statement is an opposing statement to the special creation theory. What does special creation theory say? It says that life was created as such, no changes. But this particular statement, this observation from Alfred Wallace and Charles Darwin says that, you know, in fact, they are challenging the theory of special creation. They also observed that many forms have become extinct. Again, this is an opposing statement to the special creation theory. Then they say that the organisms have built-in variation. Some genetic backup is there so that they will be able to survive in the changing environment and they will leave more progeny. If you don't have this built-in variation, you will not be selected by the nature. So nature selects only reproductively fit individuals. And the conclusion is, common ancestor, as we have seen, ancestors lived at different periods in Earth's history, that also we saw through paleontological evidences. And with changing time and environment conditions, new life forms arose. We saw that in the culture plate of bacteria. With just the change in the food, we saw that a new variety was created. And another thing is, special creation theory says that the Earth was created 4,000 years back. It is only 4,000 years old. But we now know, because of all this paleontological evidences and all, that Earth is billions of years old. Now we'll talk about one more person, Hugo de Vries, who has also studied evolution, and we'll compare his work with Charles Darwin's work. So Charles Darwin says, let me show you the photograph of Hugo de Vries and also of Charles Darwin. Now, Charles Darwin says, minor variations, some changes have accumulated over a period of time and have given rise to new species. Speciation means new species. But what does Hugo de Vries says? It's not this minor variation. He says, all of a sudden, some genetic alterations have taken place and he calls them mutation. And that is why you get a new physical expression. If the organism was producing something, now it is producing something else because the genetic makeup itself is changed. Okay? So, according to Hugo de Vries, mutations brings about speciation. While variations are very small changes which are directional towards one particular need. Like in Darwin's finches, it was towards the need for food. They are the gradual changes over a period of time. Whereas mutations, they are random, directionless, and they are spontaneous changes, not need-based. He calls it saltation. So he says speciation through mutation is just like a giant step. It was here and now it has reached to another species only because of mutation. Whereas variation, you can consider it like, you know, small jumps and then ultimately reaching to a creation of new species. So those are the differences between variations and mutations. So this is the example, this kind of examples Hugo de Vries have observed. So with continuous self-pollination, this plant would always give yellow color flower. But all of a sudden, through self-pollination only, he found that the plant in the next generation was giving a different color, somewhat like orange color. Not only in the flower color, he found similar kind of changes in other features also. So Darwin and finches, you can compare as far as the variations we are talking about, and mutations, you can compare the example of this plant. There's one plant that Hugo de Vries has studied, is called Inothera lemarckiana, garden primrose. So similar kind of mutational changes he had seen, and that is how he came to this conclusion. Okay, now let's talk about natural selection working in three different ways. So Charles Darwin, we know he has given this concept and he says that it is a driving force for evolution. We have seen examples like that, that of the industrial melanism, how nature selects the fit individual. Now if we'll see in what way the nature selects. Is there a particular pattern of selection? Yes. One is called stabilizing, one is called directional, one is called disruptive. Let's study the stabilizing type. Look at this picture here. We have very tall trees, we have very small plants, very short plants here, and we have medium sized plants. Okay. Now, if at all in this condition we find that there are strong winds, then naturally the tall plants would be affected the most. And the short plants will also be affected because they will not be getting enough sunlight. The best here would be the medium-sized plants because they are the fit individuals and the nature will select them. So neither the tall trees are selected by nature because the strong wind does not allow their existence. Short plants are not selected by nature because they cannot photosynthesize, they cannot survive. But the medium-sized plants are chosen, are selected. This kind of selection is called stabilizing kind of selection, wherein, understand this very well, the mean characteristic value, the medium size is selected over the higher extreme or over the shorter extreme. So both the extremes are not selected. The median value, or the, you can say the mean characteristics value, is selected by nature. So when you plot the graph, this is how it will look. It will show a bell shaped and the peak will be very high for the medium plant. They will have highest number of individuals in the medium sized plant. This is called stabilizing selection. Directional selection. Directional selection, on the other hand, operates a little different way. Let's see what it has to say. We'll consider same example here. Three types of neck sizes, short, medium, and very long. Okay. In this, they have to feed on tall trees. So what Darwin says is, Only those which are having very long neck will be able to, because they have those genes to have long neck, and that's why they are able to survive. So the nature has selected here the higher extreme, only one extreme. It has not selected the median, that is this medium size. It has not selected the dwarf or the short neck individual. So now when you plot the graph, see how will it be? The peak will shift towards one direction, that is long neck. Okay. So this is called directional. Suppose if it had selected only the short neck individual, let us say the food available was only grass, naturally the short neck individuals would have been at an advantage. So the peak would have shifted to this side. Okay. So in either way, whether it is this extreme or whether it is this extreme, we call it directional selection. Clear? The last one is disruptive selection. Disruptive selection operates in a very different manner. So what it says is the nature is going to select here both the extremes and not the main characteristics, not the medium trait. Okay. So if I give you this example of bunnies, white ones, gray ones and the black ones. And imagine they are living in a place where the only type of rocks in their surrounding are white ones and the black ones. So the black ones and the white ones are at an advantage because they can easily hide and be camouflaged. So who will be picked up by the predators is the gray variety. And that is why the nature has selected both the extreme, the dark color and the light color. And when you plot the graph, look at the graph, how is it? You are not getting peak in any one trait. It is showing a peak in both the two extremes, where at the intermediate trait, that is gray, it is almost flat here, right? So it has got disruptive, and that is why it is called disruptive selection. Have a very close look at this now. Let me show you something here. Imagine in this area now there are gray colored rocks and no white and black ones. What will happen in this case? The nature is going to select the gray one, right? And not the black ended. So this is stabilizing kind of reaction what we had studied with the example of the plants. So the nature operates in three ways, as I said. Let's say it at a glance. Stabilizing, where the mean value is favored by nature. Directional, where the extreme value is either the lower extreme or the higher extreme, that is selected. And in case of disruptive, both the extremes are selected and not the mean value. Clear? Okay, now that we have understood the three types of natural selection patterns, we will end here. This is the end of part 2. Part 3 will be in the next lecture.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.
अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में. ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस. अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में. ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस. अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में. ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस.